Subscribe the channel and click the bell icon to get updates on latest videos on this channel.
Namaskar, hello. A very warm welcome to everyone in today's episode of The Tree of Life. Last week, our guest, Dr. Abhishek Mishra, shared about Ayurveda and its relevance in today's time. I have received many messages from our viewers appreciating the same. I want to thank all our viewers for the love, appreciation, encouragement, and the feedback. In case you missed the last episode or you want to watch it again, you can watch it on our Facebook page, The Tree of Life Show. You can also watch it on our YouTube channel. Kindly subscribe to our Facebook page and YouTube channel for further updates. In last 400 years, human beings have made a lot of progress in science and technology. In the name of development, we have put a lot of pressure on Earth's resources, and if drastic steps are not taken to reverse all that, soon we will reach a point of no return, endangering the existence of many life forms, including humans. My guest today is a person who is a town planner and a landscape architect. She is creating designs and imbibing technologies. Those are absolutely in harmony with the nature. I am very happy today to bring Namrata Kashyap on the show. Hello, Namrata. Welcome to the show.
Hi, Vivek. How are you? And thank you so much for having me here.
I'm very good. And I'm very glad that you could join me today from your busy schedule. Thank you very much for taking time out. Namrata, during the lockdown, you shared a wonderful series called Sustainability on social media. I went through most of the episodes and was really amazed to see the nature and scope of your work. How did you come up with the sustainability series?
So Vivek, we at NKLD, as you know, that I run a sustainable and resilient design and landscape architecture practice. So we have always been very closely associated to designing with nature and, you know, minimizing our carbon footprint with any kind of design intervention that we do with our projects. But now when the pandemic hit, we were all under lockdown and, you know, I realized that spring came and went and nobody could even appreciate it. Then 22nd April, we had, you know, the Earth Day come in and go. And, you know, I kind of realized then that set me thinking that I think a lot of people like me would be thinking, where have we really gone wrong? How come we are in this position that we are today? And I thought it would be a good opportunity to actually get together all of our research, what we've been doing in terms of sustainable practices, and share it with everyone. Because I did realize that a lot of our friends, family started realizing that we need to, you know, start living right, minimizing our non-environment friendly activities. And, you know, we were probably really stretching all our resources. So we started developing this at that time, Vivek, and thought that it would be a good idea to showcase it in a way that people could really, you know, we could share the knowledge and it could be a two-way traffic. People could react and we could start a conversation like we're having now on this particular topic.
Fantastic, Namrata. Before we move forward, let's go a couple of years back. How did you got interested in this profession?
You know, I am, like you and me were in college together. When I was to join, my father had not heard of this practice at those times. I'm talking about the late 80s. The most popular professions would be medicine or civil engineering. So when I told my father I would like to go into this line, he wasn't very sure where I'm going. But I was very, very, very fond of, you know, this whole amalgamation, Vivek, of art, and science and working in a third dimension, it fascinated me. And I'm so glad I didn't regret one moment that I joined college. Of course, we had to work very, very hard with all the submissions and night outs. But I did my 4 years of town planning and I realized that I really want to go towards either environmental planning or landscape architecture. So at that point, I thought environmental planning would have a lot to do with policy making. And I thought at that point of time, I would be much more interested in doing on the ground, make a difference. So I chose landscape architecture and there I am trying to do my best at an urban scale. Since I have a town planning background, I'm able to handle very large scale projects. And also we do, the smaller interventions as the site demands. And I'm really grateful to God that I've been able to realize my dream.
That's excellent because very few people get to realize their dreams.
Yes, God's grace.
Yeah. So moving forward to the sustainability issue again, what exactly is sustainability and sustainable design?
So if you go by what is written in the dictionaries, Vivek, for sustainability, they will say, the ability to be able to maintain a certain, a kind of a certain balance. But I would say sustainable design is based on the three pillars, the three P's, that is the planet, the people, and profit. So if we are able to balance all these in equal measure, we are able to achieve the fourth and the most difficult P, which is progress. So I think sustainable design is all about respecting and trying your best not to disturb the ecological cycles of all the five elements of the universe, which is the land, that is earth, then we have air, and we have water, and we have ether, and we have fire, right? So if that is energy, fire translates to energy. So if we are able to minimize our impact on these natural cycles in terms of design, I think we are progressing towards sustainability. Then the next question would be, why should we be sustainable at all? And what is the need? And why specifically people who are in this particular field, that is building technology, why should we have a special emphasis to sustainable design? So the answer to that is that I don't know if everybody, I know that at an individual level, if you have a look at all of us, ever since we were, we all quite evolved. We're all trying to be, minimize our waste. We are trying our best to use eco-friendly materials. So that is at a very individual level. But you'll be amazed to know, Vivek, that building technology, buildings, we comprise more than 50% of the energy use of this planet. It goes into building construction, 50%. We are responsible for more than, I think, 20% of the solid waste of the planet. And we are consuming as much as 40% of the energy that we are generating on this planet for building construction. So definitely, if you see my slide, which is there, the second slide of sustainability. Yes. So I have the figures here for you. So definitely the kind of, 40% greenhouse emissions are all due to our building activity. So definitely we need to address this particular profession needs to address sustainability at a very urgent rate so as to safeguard ourselves from what we all of us are experiencing today in terms of climate change and the pandemic. So I would say sustainable architecture, you see, it is all about innovation, Vivek. It is all about trying to use technology very smartly, take a leaf out of our past and see what are our traditional practices and see how best we can use technology as a tool to move ahead with these traditional practices to maximize our output and smartly use energy and technology for a very good outcome. So sustainable architecture, I would think, is one which would have a lower cost initially as far as possible, and more importantly, on a long-term basis, it would have a minimum impact on the environment.
As you are a town planner and also a landscape architect, how the concept of sustainability is being applied in planning and landscape design?
You see, there is this quote by Charles Darwin about the theory of evolution. So he states that, it is not the strongest of the species that survives, and nor the most intelligent. It is the one that is most adaptable to change. So why is this relevant for us? Because I think architecture and design, whether it is landscape or built form, it needs to be very resilient in these times, because we are experiencing very, very challenging environments and challenging disasters, so to speak. So I think it's very important to understand that town planners and architects, the first thing we need to understand, of course, a given, which is that we have to have a sustainable practice, and whatever we design and develop has to be very resilient. So by resilient, what do we mean? Resilient is it is able to withstand some sort of a compressive stress. Now, why do we need to have resilience in design? Because you see, in earlier times when we would be designing, we would be looking at data to design in terms of what is the climate, what is the requirement, and what is the availability of materials, so on and so forth. But now we cannot predict the climate, Vivek. As you have seen, 2005, Mumbai had unprecedented floods. You know, I think as a city, they lost some $5.5 billion. They lost 1,000 or more than 1,000 lives. There was so much of loss of productivity, and there was so much of stress. So many people were distressed. Then we had, the tourist places in Himachal Pradesh, Shimla. It ran out of water, unprecedented. Cape Town had experienced day zero, no waters. There's a drought. We have a place like Nagpur and other cities where there's extreme heat. It is 4.95 degrees centigrade, unprecedented. So now we all are having to design not based on pre-recorded data, but on unprecedented for unprecedented eventualities. Because as you are pretty aware now, we've had because of urbanization, we are having a lot of calamities across the globe, whether it is the loss of biodiversity due to intensive globalization and pollution, whether it is drought due to lack of precipitation or lack of good management of the surface water flow, or whether it is the extreme heat due to industrialization and due to the population, of course, and flooding, which is a tidal event, but then storm surges and heavy rains are happening now due to deforestation. And we have landslides, of course, due to the same deforestation because of the earthquakes. We have earthquakes because we are building a lot of dams and we are having a high level of carbon dioxide pressure. So all these disasters are somehow, interwoven with each other, and they are leading to the new design brief that you and I have. So I think it's very, very important to understand that there is a very close correlation between resilience and architecture. So the right way forward now is to, if you can just show my resilience slide, please, Vivek. Yeah, so you see, resilience is about our ability as professionals to be able to anticipate what our design is going to be exposed to. Design should have the ability to absorb that impact, that exposure, and to mitigate its negative impacts on the users. And it should be able to adapt to the changing environment, whatever the case might be. So how does one go about doing this in our projects? The first thing is, even your thinking has to be very resilient. You have to understand that what I'm planning for or what I'm developing has to withstand these as a, up till now unknown parameters, but we have to now anticipate these. So as architects, as town planners, I think our policies that we are making in terms of our town level policies as well as our building bylaws have to account for all these calamities which are going to be definitely with us for the next few years till we can really get our act together and we can really start working with nature on a long-term basis.
So we can learn a lot from nature itself, because nature has been there for millions and billions of years. We can take cues from that in our design to be resilient.
Yes, Vivek, definitely. I mean, now that we are facing all of this, the first thing all of us designers have done is have started taking a look at, okay, what is standing, withstanding all these onslaught of these calamities. So if you take a look at across the globe, if you take a look, whether it is the Amazon, whether it is the Nile, whether it are these really, 1100-year-old baobab trees in Africa, somehow nature seems to have withstood all of these calamities. So what is it that we need to do? I think definitely we need to work with nature, with its ecological cycles, and possibly that is the only way forward for us. So I think biomimicry is the next thing that we designers have moved to, Vivek, where we have started studying the flora and fauna, its way of design, the way God has designed these, and taken a leaf out of that. So if you see our townships now, we have the arterials and the subarterial networks. We have actually based it on the leaf patterns. So the veins act as our circulation networks, and the subdivisions that are created are almost like cells. So that is how we have been able to actually pull out of nature biomimicry and try to imitate. Biomimicry is to imitate, but to imitate nature. So even if you see the anthill, we have a lot of studies which are now happening about how the anthill is an architectural wonder. And we have this building in Zimbabwe, which is the East Building, which is totally based on the anthill design. And I'm very happy to tell you that they have got zero dependence on any kind of external energy source, and they have natural light and ventilation. Also in Japan, if you see, the bullet train, it is, I think, face of the bullet train, the Shinkansen, I think it is called in Japan. It is, they've derived it out of, the shape of the kingfisher's, his beak. And that is how it is the fastest train in the world. So yes, there's so much to learn from nature, Vivek.
Yeah, I just saw a video of anthill, and that was fantastic. The actual anthill video. So I was just imagining what you're talking about. Must be very fascinating. Okay. So nature has its own way of functioning. An architect can decide to go downstream or upstream. What I mean to say is, how can the elements of nature be used in design without putting any pressure on nature?
I think that's a very relevant question, Vivek. First is that those who are the urban planners, they at the policy level, they have to be a lot of encouragement to using alternative or innovation in design and alternative energy sources other than the traditional fossil fuels. They should be incentivized. And I think as designers, we have already worked a lot in this field. If we talk about engineering and architecture, so we have used, we have come up with a lot of interesting innovations. We are all very well aware now of the solar panels. So using solar panels is one very good way of using, free vast energy source. Of course, there is a little bit of an installation cost. And I think Germany is really moving, at a very fast rate. And I think they have more than 60 to 70% of their public buildings on solar energy. India is also moving forward. We do have a couple of green airports now. For example, the one in Cochin in Kerala, which is 100% solar powered. So solar is, of course, a renewable source of energy, Vivek, and as you know that I think they have the photovoltaic cells, and you absorb the solar power and you are able to store it and use it for so many, so use it for cooking, they use it for generating electricity, for heat, And Tamil Nadu is also moving way forward. We have the city of Oroville, which is the outskirts of Pondicherry, where they have an entire community kitchen, which is solar powered. And it is feeding, I think, as much as 1,000 people per meal. So that is one where solar energy is a great thing that we have tapped. Then we have biodomes. Biodomes is another great innovation in terms of design. So where we have tried to create artificial environment using which is replicating or which is again imitating the earth. So where we have harsh conditions where we are unable to have grow our own and be self-sustained in terms of grow our own vegetables, have an ambient temperature, these biodomes are very useful. In fact, it was the velodrome in Montreal, which was the first experiment to have a biodome. So this is engineered and it's a very self-sufficient environment, and the ambient temperatures are maintained. And in fact, just because of the sheer design in terms of it being a sphere and having lesser surface area, about it is much more energy efficient than other traditional building design systems. So of course, if you're in Europe, you can have a look at the London Millennium Dome, the Eden Domes, or if you are up in the Americas and the Amazon spheres is a very good example of these biodomes.
Yeah, last year we visited Vienna and we visited one such place.
Yeah, it's amazing. So I think in terms, we are moving forward. Like, I don't want to sound like an all of the doomsday that things are really going wrong. I think all the designers across the world are trying to come up with great innovations. And we will move forward. We will move forward as a collective whole. And then the other thing other than biodomes is that we can do green building design. When I say green building design is when you minimize the use of concrete. So one way of doing that is by using or wherever we have to use concrete, for example, if we have earthquake prone areas, then we try our best to do earthquake resistant building design. So there we try our best to, use cross bracing. We use rubber in the foundations, the rubber layering, and then we use shear walls, have shear cores. And we try our best to design it in such a way that it is able to take a lateral as well as a horizontal shift of a couple of degrees. So that is another way of very innovative way of using technology. And then the other thing is to use the green gold as far as possible, where we have tropical some temperate zones, we have bamboo growing largely. So bamboo is a great and very, very versatile medium for construction. It is possibly one of the most sustainable materials. It is very strong. It is very light. You can easily work with it. It is very malleable. It's, of course, from the grass family. And we, I think, have more than 125 varieties of bamboos to choose from. And in India, of course, Southeast Asian countries, we have a lot of bamboo which is being used, whether it's Vietnam, it's Thailand. In India, we have Mizoram, which is leading bamboo, this whole bamboo conversion. So that's about using innovative materials. And then the other thing is in terms of respecting the most important resource now, which is water. So I think harvesting rainwater is something that is we need to address in terms of building design. So if we go back to our traditional practices, whether it is in the Indian subcontinent or it is in Europe or the Americas, everywhere we had these rainwater harvesting built forms. Whether in India we would have the ghats, we would have the baulis, we would have the kuns. So we would have, in other areas, we would have these catch basins and these reservoirs. So I think at the township level, we need to start incorporating this rainwater harvesting large basins as part of design at a township level. Individuals are definitely trying to do it in their homes. I know there are a lot of now permissions they gave only if you have a rainwater harvesting plan built into your design. But this is something which needs to be done at a community and in fact at a township level. And there need to be very good national policies to integrate all of this rainwater harvesting systems. So I think that is very important in terms of planning. And then we also have something.
What about reviving the existing water bodies, like towns like Bangalore or Delhi, which used to have, you know, hundreds of water bodies once upon a time. Now they have all run dry.
No, you're very right. You're very right. So part of this whole thing about harvesting water is that we have to revive our old existing water channels. And Delhi definitely, with the Yamuna and its tributaries, which are now, of course, called, poor things are called the Nalas, is something we need to urgently address. Bangalore was once upon a time the city of gardens. And now, unfortunately, some people call it the city of garbage, which really hurts me because I have very, very fond memories of Bangalore. But rapid urbanization has taken a toll, and the Ulsoor Lake is not what it used to be. So definitely, yes, we need to also start reviving all these water bodies and estuaries.
Taking a short break here, Namrata.
Yes.
Many of your friends are here.
Okay, hello, and I look forward to any questions or any queries. I'll be very, very happy for a two-way dialogue on this interesting topic.
I also saw in your sustainability series that you were talking about geothermal.
About geothermal systems, Vivek. That is a very interesting system where you use these polyurethane tubes. And though the temperature on the surface of the earth, it keeps fluctuating, but the one which is, say, 3 or 4 meters below is far more stable. So this energy source, it is actually a free energy source, can be used to either, maintain the ambient heat in your built form or to create cooling system as the need may be. And it essentially, it comprises of an indoor unit and a buried system of these pipes. And these are put together into a loop, and then you have a pump which either injects the hot air in or the cool air, as the case may be. And this is not something that we have recently come across, Vivek. Actually, the Native Americans, they were using geothermal, this technology for cooking, say about 1,000 years ago. So we are again just kind of delving into the past and modernizing it and using it today.
I remember in traditional houses, we used to have these bore wells inside the house, and in winters, they used to have very warm water, and in summer, it became very cold. So it was being used in India also in traditional houses.
Yes, in fact, the hot springs, the sulfur springs we have, that's again, a prime example of geothermal energy. And now a lot of people are warming up to this idea. And in fact, we are also very happy to tell you that we have started these projects. We have tried to start using a geothermal system for, maintaining ambient temperatures.
What about building and design itself, the planning itself can be used, like you can use courtyards and some other design elements?
Definitely, Vivek. I travel a lot, and I have realized that when you are traveling, because I think that is the best teacher, I came across some interesting facts. Two, one is that wherever I went, and what has survived the test of time were old civilization constructions, whether it was Pompeii of the Roman civilization, or it was Thera of the Greek. And the two things that stood out then is, one is the kind of materials that were being used that have withstood the test of time, and the spatial arrangement that was done. So if you derive out of that, I think the most outstanding feature in terms of spatial forms is the courtyard. So this courtyard is, again, a great space, a central space, which has been used in design. And if you just have a look at my slide, so this is, if you can see, the courtyard is, the central open space, and they act as, the cooling reservoirs for trapping in the cool air, letting it go through the built form on its sides. And this was, in fact, a lot of times the space which was used for also harvesting the rain waters. So this is something which definitely we can pull out of the past, and now it is coming back in a very big way in design, and we're also using the courtyard in a lot of our projects. And earlier in India, you know, these used to be, it started off as, you know, they used to have open fires in the center earlier, and then they used to have a small hole in the ceiling to let the smoke escape. And over time, they realized that the bigger the openings are, you know, the better it is in terms of design. So definitely spatial form, I would say courtyard is one of my favorites if you borrow from the past.
I have also used a lot in my projects. Courtyard, fact, and, you know,
now, so even I'm trying my best to use my courtyard and then to do all my rainwater harvesting and my treatment of waters there.
So you're an ardent traveler and exposed to various cultures and regions. How have you tried to adopt traditional design practices and imbibing them in congruence with the technology?
So Vivek, once we traveled around, I came across that one was about Indian. And then, like I said, when we traveled, we saw some very innovative materials which were being used in different parts of the world. So some of these they used a lot of rammed earth. So even in where I live here in Goa, in the Portuguese times, the old Portuguese houses were actually built with rammed earth. And if you see, these are, you know, walls which are made with the local mud, which is available. They are put into a kind of a framework and they are rammed in. They look very beautiful. They are 100% sustainable and you really can't get more local than that. So this is again something which I wish to, you know, we all like-minded designers wish to revive. And again, this is doesn't even need any kind of an external finish. So there you save again in terms of cost and in terms of your environment. We don't have to use any kind of plaster over it. So I think rammed earth has been a great thing that I have experienced, whether it is in Portugal, in India, and in different parts of Europe.
What was the reason that why most of the people are not still using rammed earth construction?
I think it takes time. Anything which is beautiful, I think, takes a little time. And concrete, I think, has been very smartly able to market itself as a very sturdy, as, you know, ISI compliant, so on and so forth, material. And I think somewhere we have also dropped it as a something of being old-fashioned or a thing of the past. And, you know, it being a load-bearing structure, there's really not much you can do at subsequent levels. So since we're going more into high-rises, that's where then the limitation of the rammed earth comes in. But I would definitely think that at the residential scale or for community buildings, we would definitely like to encourage the use of rammed earth.
Another thing that comes to my mind is my meeting with the architect Laurie Baker. Okay, we went to Kerala as a school trip and we organized, like the whole batch was invited to his house, and it was an eye-opening experience for us. Do you also think the same about using brick in the design?
Definitely, Vivek. I think Laurie Baker was the Mahatma Gandhi of, you know, sustainable design. And I think the way he has innovatively used brick, I don't think we have come even close to that kind of, you know, creativity or that kind of ingenuineness. And I think his astuteness in being able to do away with whatever were the unnecessary or the redundant design details. So I think this is again something we definitely need to take out of his book, this the Laurie Baker's basic approach, whether it comes to, you know, using slabs with you have terracotta pots in it. It again reduces the load of the slabs, to using jalis instead of windows, which are done innovatively out of brick, to use upcycle bottles, whether it is beer bottles or wine bottles, to create a stained glass effect. I mean, it is immense. And what he does, his barrel walls, that so we don't have to use any kind of lintels across. I think this is also something we really need to revive and encourage back into design.
When I saw your sustainable series, there were two elements which caught my attention. Okay, one was this gabion wall.
Yes.
Okay, and thermo wood.
Right.
So you can share more about them with our viewers. It was very wonderful to read about them.
Yes. You see, the gabion wall, it derives its name from the word gabion. So gabion means a cage in Italian. And these cages, essentially a gabion wall is a framework of a wired cage, which is then filled up with the local stones which are available. And these are used as veers, as retaining walls. And in olden times, in Egyptians, in fact, used to use them for, you know, they used to, in fact, make the gabion cages out of reeds and put stones, and they would put it onto the bed of their river so as to fortify the base and to prevent erosion. So that is what they did to the River Nile. And today it is being used very smartly in design. As you can see, they also use it in landscape. You can also use it as sculptures. You can use them as planters. You can use them as seaters. You can use them as dividers. And you can also use them just as a very nice interior wall. So I think gabion wall is again something which is totally environment friendly. It is a great design alternative. And again, it needs no kind of a surface cladding. And the other thing you mentioned was thermo wood, Vivek.
Right.
Yeah. So thermo wood is again something very exciting. We haven't really got exposed to it in the Indian subcontinent, but it is being vastly used in the Americas. So thermo wood is all about using this Finnish pine, and it is then dehydrated at very high temperatures, higher than 200 degrees centigrade. As a result, then it becomes very, very sturdy, and it is then it can be used as an alternative again to concrete, and can be used for piers, for making wooden parts, for internal flooring and for cladding. And it's a great landscape option. You can see in my slide some of the innovative ways that it has been used. Yeah, so it not only is very good to look at, it is also very cost effective. And again, it is a homogeneous material. It doesn't have to have any kind of camouflaging or any kind of layering to maintain it. At the most, it needs some kind of a stain or a little bit of a paint on the timber to just enrich its color.
That's wonderful to look at. Namita, what are the challenges of modern civilization, and how are you trying to solve through your work? Not necessarily by your projects, but by adopting new technologies, by teaching and by research.
I think the first thing that comes to my mind, Vivek, is when we've done a lot now, the way we are in modern times, is that we all know that, oh my God, we should not be using plastic. We need to minimize it. It is devastating our oceans and our landfill sites. So definitely we have to stop its production. But you know what? We can't do away with what we already have on the planet. And that is like a lot. So I think a very interesting thing is to do innovation in design in terms of how do we upcycle this plastic. Because we can't burn it, it is polluting, we can't dump it on our land, it leads to leaching, and definitely the havoc it is playing with the marine life in the oceans. So that brings us to the most interesting thing, I think, is recycling of plastic to use in building technology. So I think some people are innovative. I know some very good builders here who have come up with very, very smart tiles. This is interlocking pavers. We have the national highways, which are now being made out of plastic waste. And we are constructing roofs, as you can see in the picture on the left. We are using it in a lot of very interesting walls by filling up these plastic bottles, by putting chicken mesh on either side, and then filling it with any kind of an inert material. A lot of green walls are being made by using these bottles and using them as planters and mural walls, so on and so forth. So I think upcycling this plastic is something we really need to adopt in terms of design. I think all of us designers need to actively make sure that we have at least some aspect of our project which is upcycling such materials.
Amita, there's a question coming up for you. One of the viewers is asking, I'm putting this question on the screen. So Mr. Rajiv Kashyap is asking, is acoustics an issue with thermal wood walls of rooms?
Yes. Hello, hello, Mr. Rajiv Kashyap, and thank you so much for joining in. I think what you're trying to ask me is that, is it because the acoustics in terms of that whether the sound travels from room to room if we are using these? So I think when a lot of times what we do, Mr. Kashyap, is that we have cavity walls with this thermo wood, and we fill it with some kind of soundproof material. It could be fiber wool, or it could be any other kind of inert material. So that minimizes the sound travel from one habitable space to another. I hope that answers your question.
Okay, Namrata, you were talking about recycling of plastics.
Yes.
So there are many other things which require recycling.
Vivek, other than recycling plastics, the next thing that comes to my mind is about how we have to get rid of this culture of use and throw. You know, this is what the generation had come to, and of course we are also guilty about it, to just throw away whatever we've used once. But we are all now responsible for all the waste that we generate. So we are now actively doing research in using biodigesters in all our plants, all our projects. So biodigesters, excuse me, are basically anaerobic centers, or it's a small unit. And what we do is that whatever is your agricultural waste on that particular project, it could be the trimming of the leaves, the twigs, the leaf fall, or any other kind of kitchen waste as well, is what you can put into these biodigesters. And these, through, without the presence of oxygen, through anaerobic or through bacterial, breaking down of this material, we are able to generate what is called biogas, which can be used for cooking. And then also the byproduct of that is the biofertilizer, which can be used back again for the planting. So I think biodigesters is again, at the policy level, something that we should encourage all our projects, all our real estate developers to have as part of their development, whatever the project scale may be, whether it's a residential or a commercial or even an individual scale. So DEDCO digesters are the one of the most creative modules. And it is, in fact, designed to a family unit also, Vivek. It can be used even for a family of as small as four people. And there you go. You can also reduce your bills for your LPG and use biogas instead.
All right. I will read some messages for you. There are many viewers sending messages. Sarita Chaudhary is saying it's very informative session. Manisha Lath Gupta, so informative and insightful, Namrata, enjoying listening to you. And Navita Kashyap is saying a very different and alternative approach to architecture, very informative. Radhika Parekh, very informative, awesome.
Thank you, Navita.
So a lot of good information has been shared. Manisha, yeah, we can hear you. Anjali Lamba, awesome, quite informative. Rohini Sekri, interesting and informative. We need to move towards an eco-friendly approach in all spheres. Radhika Parakh, awestruck about the depth of knowledge you have about nature as a famous and successful architect. And
thanks, Radhika.
Yeah, Tanveer Chaudhary, relevant topic.
Thank you, Tanveer.
You're inspiring a lot of people today.
Thank you. Thank you so much for my friends and family for being out there. Thank you.
So we talked about recycling of plastics, and we talked about biodigester. What about recycling of water?
Yes, as a lot of people say that possibly the next war is going to be on water. So definitely we need to intelligently recycle whatever water that we are using Vivek, in urbanized spaces or in design. So what comes to my mind immediately is that we need to address all the three forms of water byproducts that we have. The first of all is gray water. How to intelligently recycle gray water. So when I talk of gray water, it is waters which are wastewater, which comes out of our kitchen sink, out of the bath, out of the laundry, out of washing your cars, everything other than what comes out of the flushing of the toilets. So that is called gray water. So this water is used and it is collected by some kind of collecting mechanism through piping, and it is taken to a centralized treatment. Now this treatment could be done either through our plants, which is phytoremediation, or it is done through some kind of filters. These could be sand filters, they could be charcoal filters, and then this water is reused and put back for either flushing our toilets again, or again it is used in a landscape. So definitely we need to, as far as possible, like I had mentioned earlier, that sustainability is all about minimizing our interference into water cycle, into cycles. So in here is we try our best to replicate or mimic the hydrological cycle, and we try our best to put the water back into the a cycle. And the other is this is gray water. The other is to use intelligently reuse black waters. So this term black water was coined in the 1970s, and it is about the water which is coming out of our toilets, which essentially, or our urinals, which is essentially containing feces or urine. So this waters can also be treated, contrary to popular belief. And the two ways are to, first of all, try to minimize black water. This can be done by having what are called vermicomposting toilets or composting toilets. So you don't have to use water for flushing. And the other is, if you have your traditional, you know, the WCs, then you use what are called this decentralized waste water treatment systems, or the DWAT system. So this is not a mechanical system. It is totally natural, where again, by the use of bacteria, we have anaerobic baffle tanks and filters where the water goes through some six filtrations and through this bacterial chambers where all the solid matter is broken down. And then this water is settled, polished, and this water can again be used for irrigation. It is not potable water, but definitely it can be used for irrigation or in cooling towers for air conditioning. So there's another intelligent way of reusing this black water. And then we come to storm water. When we do a lot of building activity, we have a lot of surface area in terms of roofs. So how do we, all the waters that we have, which are accumulated on our roofs, which are in through our pathways, we could channelize all of this waters and then let it go through natural cleaning beds using pebbles, using suitable plant species. So this is able to be filtered and it is again reused. And this water is relatively clean water. In fact, the Changi Airport in Singapore, I think a good 28 to 33% of this water, or the waters that they have, is all from the storm water that they accumulate. So then I have a very interesting thing is what the last thing what I showed you is about phytoremediation. So phytoremediation is how to purify water, we use suitable plant species as filters. And this phytoremediation can also be used, Vivek, wherever we've got contaminated sites, wherever we have, let's say, abandoned mining sites or abandoned quarries. So we have these brown fields. So a lot of suitable plants can be put in these areas, such as the Indian mustard, the eucalyptus, the sunflowers. And they end up breaking down whatever are the abandoned metal, what is random metal, which is there in the soil, and convert it into rejuvenate the soil and convert all these, break down all these metals into basic elements.
That's so much of knowledge, Samantha. I have more messages for you. Vandana Mishra is saying, nice to hear this interesting information. Aradhana Handa, please do share your slide presentation on Google Drive or Cloud for more extensive read. And Mr. Rajiv Kashyap is asking again, you need to talk about the plastic path pavers. So maybe you can talk a little more about plastic path pavers.
Okay, so these plastic pavers, Mr. Rajiv Kashyap, are now being they're being manufactured in a very big way, particularly in India. And what they're doing is that they're choosing the plastics based on their color and their micron level. And then these are being compressed and they are turned into pavers. And these pavers are so strong that even normally if you use a concrete paver, which is a depth of about, say, 30 to 50 to 80 mm, and they are the ones, the 80 mm is what is able to take on the load of a fire tender. But these plastic pavers, just at 25 mm, are so strong that they can take a weight two times that of a fire tender. So this is something definitely it's a win-win situation for us. And now that we have this plastic and we can't do away with it, we are definitely able to convert it into a smarter building material, which is slimmer in size. It is much lighter than using concrete pavers. Its technology is far more green technology, using clean energy as against manufacturing these concrete pavers. It doesn't need any kind of coloring that you need to add to these pavers, because the plastics themselves are, we have already used a lot of colored plastics. So they're just segregated based on their colors. And these are, again, homogeneous color. There is no kind of a surface treatment. They are anti-skid. And they have, like, plastic is going to last us forever. So they're definitely going to, these pavers are definitely going to outlive the next five generations that buy that particular property. So I think this is definitely something of the future, and we must adopt these in design. And they're still in nascent stages. They've just come out a few months ago. But again, we as designers hope to use them in our projects as far as possible to also reduce the quantum of, plastic that we have in our landfill sites.
That was excellent, and the whole series which I saw for last 4 months, you gave a beautiful summary in 45-50 minutes. Though we cannot have everything, but still we learned about all the concepts which you were sharing, and I think our viewers also must have got a lot of idea about new technologies. And once you upload your presentation to some drive, and people can really go through it.
We have our all this entire sustainable series on our all our social media pages, and we have detailed presentations on these. We have just put up a very small snippet of it, but we have detailed presentations where there is a full in-depth analysis of all these materials available on our website. So should anybody from the viewers would like to go further into it, we'll be very happy to engage with you and to share our knowledge, because it's all about sharing what we have. And you are more than welcome to also come onto our website and read more about any of the presentations, or contact us. I'll be very happy to engage with you and take this further.
Would you like to give any message to our viewers?
First of all, thanks for being with me in this. I think it's a very relevant topic. All of us are now, thinking about our actions and trying to do our bit. I certainly believe that we can do a lot, at an individual level. All of us are trying our best, like I said, to be, upcycle, to minimize, to reuse, reduce our carbon footprint. But there's a lot which we can do as a community. In terms of the academicians need to start emphasizing a lot about environmental education at the school levels, at the college levels. And of course, when you are training professionals like technocrats, whether it be architects, engineers, or planners, the you know, I think it is very important to know that this being a technocrat is, I think it's not a profession, it is a service, because you are the translator of what the people want as against what the planet needs. So that balance, the onus of maintaining that balance is on you, the technocrats. So that's very important. And then you have the bureaucrats who are making the policies. So I think being sensitive from, you know, initial stages, or let it be part of their training, is very important. And then finally, the politician who knows that he's answerable to all these aware individuals. So they are obviously going to only vote the person in power who is going to be sensitive to the environment and, like, you know, the three components of sustainability, which is people, the planet, and the profit. So an economy which is based on balancing our resources and humanity, I think, is the way forward. And I think we all as a community need to work towards achieving this balance, because I think that is the only way that all of us are going to make it out of here.
Two more messages for you, Namrata. I will read for you. Mani Pangan, I understand plastic paper is costlier by 25% than the conventional ones. Government's environment budget and corporate CSR budgets need to be invited to bear costs.
Thank you.
I can also put on the screen.
I think the latest papers which are coming out now, Mr. Mani Pangan, are not that expensive. They are, I think, to the best of my knowledge, 35 rupees a square foot. And we have very similar costs for concrete pavers. But I think when we start also analyzing costs, we need to understand that the cost goes beyond the economics of money. It is also what is the environmental cost, what is the environmental impact. And I agree with you that maybe what we can do is that CSR or government needs to further fund or these particular units so that they can further reduce the cost of their product, and that way more of us can buy. And I think that's a very good suggestion. Maybe we can definitely take that forward with the government.
One of my friend is asking a question. Ma'am, can you give an insight of how to develop a small 4,000 square feet land into an eye-catching farmhouse with great landscaping? Moreover, plants which grow very fast within an year at Lucknow climate.
Definitely. What is the name of the viewer, please?
Atul Verma.
Hello, Mr. Verma. Definitely we can. And I would encourage you, Mr. Verma, to get in touch with us. We can have a dialogue, and we need to definitely, you know, see your site, because like I told you earlier, we need to do a proper analysis of where your site is, what are the conditions it is exposed to, what is your design brief, and definitely we can help you. We'll be very happy to get in touch with you and take this forward.
Abhimanya Mani saying, beautifully summarized. Mansi Baveja Agarwal, with the new education policy in place, would it be useful to have such sustainable development practices incorporated in small scale in schools and universities?
Definitely, Mansi. What I was just mentioning here, that it is very important to bring this awareness right into the individual from their nascent stages, from right up from the schools. And I know that a lot of schools which we are designing now, Mansi, they are having us build them with sustainable materials, and they are wanting us to have a small area to showcase what exactly is, you know, organic farming, encourage children to grow their own food and expose them to, you know, how farm to the table, what is the whole process. So it's very important, because most of us otherwise, you know, would wish away what is our waste and say it is another person's job. We wouldn't know where our food came from and where our waste went. So I think that those cycles need to be cut short, and each individual needs to be made responsible for what we generate and how we, what we do with it.
Are you more messages? Gopi Shunglu, people wants, planet needs, balance, it's more important. Well said.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Gopi.
Thank you, Namrata, for having a wonderful conversation today. Keep doing the good work that you are doing, and I wish you all the best.
Thank you so much, Vivek. And we all are going through this current situation, but I want to give one message to everybody that, hey, you know, when all of us are faced with a crisis, either we can regress or we can learn from it and progress. So I think we all need to choose the latter, and together we can do it. Thank you for hosting me on this show, Vivek. It has been a complete pleasure and honor. And I'll be very happy to engage with any further queries, or if you would like us to go through any more of our sustainable series, we'll be so happy to share them with you.
Sure, Namrata. Thank you very much. All the best.
Thank you. Thank you. And have a good evening.
This conversation with Namrata Kashyap would be available on our Facebook page, Tree of Life Show, and YouTube channel. Kindly subscribe to our Facebook page and YouTube channel. So friends, that is all for today. Next week, I will be here again with another personality. Till then, take a good care of yourself. God bless you all.